So with that, let's turn in our Bibles to 1 Timothy 4, title of our study today, A Light in the Darkness. If you go through the archives, you'll notice this title appears in many studies and many portions of the Bible, but I want to assure you every study itself is different. What they have in common is that Jesus has always been the light of the world and that he tells us we, his sons and daughters, his brothers and sisters, his family and fellowship, that we are in this very dark world, the light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. And he said, let your light so shine before men that they'll see your good works and glorify who? That's right, your Father in heaven. Well, 1 Timothy 4, a light in the darkness. I want to say then, wherever you go, whatever you do, you are the light of the world. And you should already know, light and darkness don't mix. That's why when you go into a dark room, you don't yell at the darkness, get out, get out. And you simply flip the light switch, the darkness flees, and you who are the light are now in the light. But we have a problem culturally, and it's always been a problem. It's not a new phenomenon. Men who love darkness hate the light. Jesus says that's why they won't come to the light lest their deeds be exposed as evil. Well, young Pastor Timothy ministered in a very dark time, in a very dark city, in a culture deceived, very much like ours is today, in a church beset by savage wolves and self-appointed apostles. In order to be effective for the Lord, young Timothy would have to overcome all those obstacles and many others. Timothy in his day and we in ours are faced with a culture that's bent on replacing all God's done, creation, the fall, the flood, the Tower of Babel, the Word of God, the nation of Israel, his church. They want to replace all that with futile and self-destructive ideas created by mere men who are dead in trespasses and sins. And I want to suggest it's foolish to trade light for darkness, hope for hopelessness, faith for, well, misplaced faith. So Paul lays out for young Timothy, and it will be so useful to us today. I'm so grateful that there are so many young men and young women here besides those of us who are middle-aged. And now that you laugh at. First five verses, he identifies the liars and lies of all who reject and replace God's word with the wisdom of men. Wisdom God calls foolishness, by the way. Verses 6 through 11, by declaring the truth, by being a faithful teacher, sharing and preaching the word and will of God. Verse 12, by living the truth as an obedient servant, living out the word and walking in God's will. Verses 13 through 16, by growing in the truth, maturing in the faith, fruitful and faithful to the word of God. Now, last week we looked at pastoral priorities. It had to do with Timothy because this is the first of two letters Paul writes to young Pastor Timothy, telling him how to succeed in ministry. And it's not a course you can take, it's a lifestyle you adopt. And so last week, pastoral priorities were laid out: character, temperament, experience, and reputation. But it's important that you realize today, if you didn't last time or weren't here last time, that these priorities, while they must be a reality for the pastor teacher, for the elder or overseer of a fellowship, they're absolutely essential for every parent, for every big brother or big sister in the Lord. We have a clip at the end of the service called Jesus Revolution. It's the history, but it's going to be a very different kind of history story. But it's the history of the Jesus movement in Southern California. And back in that day, people were getting saved. My peers, hippie musicians and hippie artists and just hippies. And they were opening up houses where the elders of the house, the spiritual leaders in the house, they were only a week or 2 weeks or a month old in the Lord. And they were going out to the streets and talking about Jesus to those people. And people were coming to Christ in droves. And by droves, I mean thousands and tens of thousands. Now, they would bring them to the house. They'd share the Lord with them. They'd share a meal with them. And then they'd say, hey, you can stay here if you want. So there were these little hippie communes growing up. There'd already been some, but they were nothing like this. Because every day, all day long, people were studying the Word of God for the first time or understanding the Word of God for the first time. And then they'd hit the streets. And there'd be a guy sharing the Lord who's been a Christian for a month. He's the leader of the group. And then there's a guy who just gave his life to the Lord yesterday. He's sharing the Lord too. And I'm not saying we got to get back to those days any more than we got to get back to first century church, because there were problems in both. But what I am saying is God was doing something in that day where thousands and thousands of spiritual orphans found Christ, were born again of the Spirit, adopted into the family of God, adopted in. Now they got brothers and sisters in the Lord and mothers and fathers in the Lord and little brothers and sisters in the Lord. So as we look today at what he has to say about the latter times, the latter days, it's going to be important to us because we are in fact living in those very days. So the Spirit, verse 1, chapter 4, 1 Timothy, the Spirit expressly says, in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. This departure from the faith, it's the word apostasy, or the Greek word from which we get our word apostasy. It is a willful rejection of God's word, of God's will, of God's wisdom. Now, the picture that develops for us is the one who departs, and this is oh so important, the one who departs from the faith is not a believer who no longer believes, but one who professed faith in the truth that never took root in his heart. How do we know? Because the words that are used here make that an essential reality. Jesus tells in the parable of the sower, he says that when the word of God is sown, it's sown in the hearts of men. And this is important because it's not just the gospel, but the gospel must be preached, because without it, no one will be saved. No one will find forgiveness. No one will become a part of the family of God, born again of his Spirit and sealed until the day of redemption with that same Holy Spirit, by that same Holy Spirit. So this departure from the faith is one of four things that happens in the parable of the sower. Jesus just said the sower goes out to sow seed, and as he does, some falls by the wayside, the birds come and snatch it away, and then, well, it never produces any fruit, of course. And so, by the way, as he went through this, The disciples are listening, and when he's all done, they say, hey, could you explain all that to us? Because they didn't understand it. They didn't put it together. So if you've read those parables and you're like, I didn't get them, well, you're in good company. Peter, James, John, the rest of the fellas, they didn't understand it either. So the first thing that can happen is that the bird steals the seed. And he, when he explains it, says it's a demonic thing. It's the birds like are representing Satan there. And he comes in to steal away the truth before it can take root and produce fruit in your life. Before someone can actually truly understand what it is to be forgiven all sin and adopted into the family of God. And the second case, the seed falls on very shallow, hard-packed, actually it's rocky ground. And so there might be a little bit of soil, just enough for the seed to get there and try to shoot out a root, but there's nowhere for the root to attach itself because there's no depth of soil. And that's what's going on in this particular chapter, in this particular passage. And so I'll make that clear to you in a moment. In the third case, the cares of the world and deceitfulness of riches choke out the good seed so it never takes root and produces fruit. It kind of gets a start, but then the weeds come in, and he calls those weeds the cares of the world, just the regular stuff we all deal with. And the deceitfulness of riches, the idea that if we only had that, then we could get this. And if we only had this, then we'd be happy. He says that chokes out the good seed of God's word. But then some of the seed falls on good ground. Jesus explains that that good ground is a heart prepared for the seed of God's word. And this is why I share it with you. It's not just about the gospel. It's about right here, right now. And every time you open the word or read the word or hear the word, the condition of your heart will determine if that word is going to be effective in changing your life. So it's a huge issue. And in Luke's version of this, there's one, of course, in Matthew and then one in Luke. In his version of it, he says, the ones on the rock are those when they hear, receive the word with joy, but have no root, who believe for a while and in time of temptation, trial or testing fall away. The seed finds little soil, and this is an explanation of that. The seed finds little soil on the stone, but is not enough to take root, so the growth is only seasonal. And when testing comes, there's no root to hold it down. I share this with you because there are people teaching that a real believer in Christ Jesus can lose his or her salvation. That's not a biblical teaching because when Jesus gives us everlasting life, it is everlasting. When he gives us the Holy Spirit, who seals us until the day of redemption. And our spirit begins to bear spirit witness with his spirit that we are the children of God. That's a done deal. That's an accomplished fact, a forever reality. So when people say, well, here's an example of somebody losing their salvation. I did a word study on it. If you're not familiar with those, when you study a chapter, you kind of got to look at each section of the chapter. And then, of course, you boil it down and there are paragraphs and there are movements within. And then you get down to where you're studying sentences and you get down to where you're studying words. If you just study the words and you don't look at the context, a lot of it won't make any sense. Or you can't be sure what it's saying. The context will always be the key for understanding the words within. So when it comes to word studies, it's important because it'll come back up later in the study, by the way. But there are four Greek words for love. Three are in the Bible. The one storge that isn't in the Bible, there's a form that could be a reference to it. But eros, that's physical, natural, sensual love. The word erotic comes from it. Doesn't mean all eros is bad. It just means that it is a love that causes problems if there's not actual love there. And then there's, of course, a philos. We get the city of Philadelphia. Delphi is it's brotherly love. Philos's love, Delpha is brotherly. So the city of brotherly love. And then there's agape, and that's the fourth. So you have storge, you have eros, you have philos, and then you have agape. That's the love that God showed us because he so loved the world. He gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, but have eternal life. So this word cannot and does not indicate uprooting. That would be like, you know, something that's alive losing its life. There never was a root. The temporary plant stood by itself. The union with the soil was only an apparent union, never a true foundation with roots capable of holding up the plant. So, he says, the Spirit expressly says in latter times, some will depart from the faith. This isn't, again, a believer departing from the truth. We wander, but he comes after us. He leaves the 99 to go after the one wandering sheep because we're his sheep, you see. Giving heed to deceiving spirits, seducing spirits, and doctrines, precepts of demons. Those are fallen angels speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared or cauterized as with a hot iron. Now, this giving heed is interesting. It's actually used in as a nautical word, and it's for keeping your ship on a preset course, even if that course leads to destruction. And that's what people are doing. They're departing from the faith by giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. They set a course, but it's not a course established by the Lord or the one the Lord has traveled first for us and says, follow me. Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience. I read it seared with a hot iron. You know, if you're wounded, and some of you guys are wilderness guys, some of you gals are wilderness gals, you know well, if you're out in the wilderness and you're far from civilization, from doctors or any medical help, and you wound yourself severely, one of the only ways to stop the bleeding, if you can't do it any other way, if the tourniquet doesn't work and everything you learn in first aid or in Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, if none of that works, you can take a knife and put it in the fire and you can put it onto the wound. It will sear that sucker and it will stop the bleeding. Now you're gonna have a nasty scar. Most guys who would do that would like us to see their scar. But I'm just saying that's the word that's used here. And it's saying the conscience God's given us and super activated by his Spirit because everyone has a conscience. That's why before God ever gave Israel the law, he could judge people and do it justly and righteously. Because he judged them according to conscience. He knows what we're thinking. He knows what we're feeling. He knows what we're going to do before we do it. So he's never shocked or caught off guard or like, now what do I do? That happens to us, but not to him. So this idea is someone's on a course that was set for them by deceivers and liars, by people in darkness. They're saying, follow me and I'll lead you to the life that you won't believe it. And some of us lived it and we believed it. And it was, we're happy to have escaped it and be in the light and be on course, not the one set by men, but the one set by God for us. A course that makes our life meaningful now, fruitful now, useful and glorifying to God now, a blessing to people now. And it ends with us standing at the throne of God in heaven and hearing the Father speak, well done, good and faithful servant, enter in to the joy of the Lord. Well, these who get off, who are seduced and begin to follow those who are demonically led and demonically used, Well, it says their conscience is seared with, again, a hot iron. Now, there are some who are today deceived, and they don't know that they're deceived. They've been deceived by people who shared who just didn't know the truth. There's hope for them. They can escape. There are some who are duplicitous. What does that mean? It means they lie, and then they believe their own lie. That was like Satan. We looked at, I think, last week or the week before, I will, Isaiah 14, if you want to look it up later. And God says, no, you won't. Satan can tell himself, I'm going to rule. I'm going to sit on the mount of the congregation. I'm going to be like the Most High. But that's not true. He lied to Eve. He said, you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Listen, you can't be more like God than having been created in his image, being the only two people on planet Earth, fellowshipping with him daily. The lie is you could be more like him. You could be just like him. And it's crazy, but Eve believed the lie. She denied the truth. She believed the lie. She ate what was forbidden to her. Well, and then Adam, I don't get him at all, but he's like, hey, give me some of that. And well, she gave it to him and he ate it. The difference in the two, she was deceived by Satan. He ate it willingly. I don't know which one's worse. Both are bad because God said, in the day you eat, you will die. And Satan said, you're not going to die. That's what happens today. Godly people warn you, hey, don't go down that path. That's the road to destruction. Don't get involved in the depravity and insanity and the obvious, ridiculous ideas and opinions of men regarding things that everybody has agreed on for all of human history. But all of a sudden, we have a whole new landscape with things unimaginable to most sane people all the way up till now. Well, anyway, forbidding to marry, because this is kind of, you know, where he digs in here. The word forbidding means restraining, preventing, and marriage, it's God's first and primary institution. Why? Because he wants a godly seed. He created Eve from Adam, brought her to Adam. He said, this is the one. I mean, it's not like he had a lot of choices, but he did choose her. And then they consummated their relationship. The two became one flesh. Children were born to them. But listen, sadly, most of the stuff that you know, in their marriage, well, all the bad stuff happened after the fall. We don't know how long they walked with God in the garden and heard his voice and fellowshipped with him and basked in his glory. We don't know how long that went on, but we know once they sinned, that was over. Oh, God still wanted them, still loved them, still reached out to them, but everything was different. And so it is with sin. And so if someone has deceived you and you realize you've been deceived, all you need to do is turn that around. Turn away from the deceiver. Turn away from the deception. Embrace the truth. Walk in light with the Lord. And your life will become what God intends it to be. If you are a duplicitous person, if you lie, and you don't even need a liar to tell you the lie, you make it up and then you believe it yourself. There's still hope for you, but I want to say, man, I would give my life to the Lord right away if I was that person, because who knows if God says, okay, that's enough, I'm done. And he has and can do such a thing. Well, forbidding to marry. These spiritual giants, these spiritual leaders, these guys who were telling Tim, don't listen to that stuff, and this is where it's at. You don't have to be married. And listen, the culture was promoting licentious living, all sorts of immorality and idolatry and everything harmful. And these heretics, they go to the other extreme. They're like saying marriage itself is bad. Now, Jesus would disagree, though he was never married. Paul would disagree, and we think he may have been married because he was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was a Pharisee. But he said he preferred being single. There's no way he would have divorced his wife. She probably wrote him off if it's true that they were married. But nonetheless, he says, listen, for him personally, it's better not to marry, better to be in the situation he's in. So I do have a word for you younger guys and gals. If you decide to marry, that's a good thing. He who finds a wife finds a good thing. If you decide that you're not going to marry, that's fine. God doesn't say you have to be married to have a good life, a fruitful life, a life that brings glory to him. But if you're going to stay single, you have to stay celibate. If you don't know what celibate is, look it up later, not now. But I'm pretty sure most understanding that would say, you know what, the whole married life sounds good to me. Because celibacy, that's a high and holy calling. But we're already called to a high and holy calling, just doing the things that come natural, as long as they're not, well, sinful. So anyway, apostasy, the soil, false doctrine, again, the heart. The source of false doctrine, deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. The spread of false doctrine, giving heed to and speaking lies in hypocrisy. The seduction is complete when the conscience is seared with a hot iron. And the doctrines that he mentions, first one is marriage, and then commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. Forbidding here means commanding. That means they were lording it over, something Jesus told his disciples not to do. These guys were trying to take charge of others in the congregation. Rather than just sharing the word of God, they were sharing their will and their desire and their plan for someone else. Now, when it comes to food, there are a lot of things in the Old Testament regarding diet. It's not the biggest issue in the Old Testament. There are things there I can't understand at all. Finishing Exodus in the next week or two, be in Leviticus next, and there'll be some things in there related to diet. We get to Deuteronomy, it comes up again, but God had to tell them, don't eat bats. I don't know why God had to tell him not to eat bats. Have you ever looked at a bat and thought, I wonder, you know? It's like, no, you want to get rid of it. You want to make sure it doesn't come back. But in any case, this comes out of Peter's experience, by the way, where his experience with the Lord on a day where he was on the roof, they're making food below, he's pretty hungry, he's kind of dazed, and he's just, you know, daydreaming and looking up into the heavens, and he sees a great sheet let down from heaven. And he hears a voice, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." It was the Lord speaking to him. And he knew it because he said, "Not so, Lord." I don't think those go together, you know. Not so, and Lord, no way, Lord. That'll never happen to you. He says, not so, Lord. Nothing unclean has ever passed through these lips. The truth is, all sorts of unclean things had passed through those lips. They were just coming the other direction. Because Jesus, dealing with this issue, will go on to say it's not what goes into a man that defiles him, but what comes out of the mouth. This defiles a man. Those things which proceed out of the mouth come from, get ready for it, the heart. All of this is about the heart. And they defile a man. Out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man. This is the context of that whole thing is the disciples weren't going through the ceremonial washing that was so popular among some of the religious leaders. And Jesus says, you're all mixed up on what matters most. Nothing coming in is going to defile you, at least not that way. But what comes out, it is a revelation of how dark you are within. It's a revelation of the depth of depravity within a man. Because all of those sins he mentions, they happen and come from the heart. Well, in any case, he goes on in verses 6 through 11 to say, if you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. A good minister not only warns God's flock about savage wolves and false doctrine and false teachers, he must feast on the word himself and study to show himself approved, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Every believer, and Tim was young, but listen, it's not about how old you are as far as your natural age. It's about how spiritual you are, how mature you are in the Lord. Timothy is a young guy who's mature in the faith. And I want to tell you, there are a lot of older saints, they're real saints, they're going to be in heaven, but who are very immature in the faith. Why? Because immaturity requires at least these two things, time in the word and submission to the word. First, you have to be men and women of the word of God. And then the word has to work its way into the fabric of your core, the who you are in heart. And so you're nourished, you're cleansed by the word, you're washed in the water of the word every time you open the word of God. So, good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith, the good doctrine, which you've, speaking to Timothy, carefully followed. I want to be able to say that. For all you young men and all you older men and those of you who are still younger than me and you're old, I want to be able to say these guys and these gals love the Lord and love the word and they live the life. They're the light of the world and the world can see it. But he goes on to say, verse 7, reject profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourselves toward godliness. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable in all things, having promise of the life that is now and of that which is to come. I've noticed some people's intellectual diet consists of the latest gossip or ideas or ever evolving, and I should say ever devolving opinions, but the wise feed and feast on God's word. On the truth. And this is a faithful saying, he says in verse 9, and worthy of all acceptance. For to this end, we both labor and suffer reproach because we trust in the living God who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe. These things command and teach. Now, there's a movement afloat at this time and this season, especially among younger believers, and I'm saying young in age and believers, and it's all about not wanting to acknowledge that the wages of sin is death, that people are going to die without Christ and go into a Christless eternity in a place that's real, that Jesus talked about more than heaven, a place called hell. I get why people don't want to hear it or believe it, but we can't unbelieve it away. It's reality. And so this is also important. When he says he's the Savior of all men, he's talking about the blood that Jesus shed, the death he died, the fact that he died for our sins according to the scripture, he was buried and he rose again. He is the Savior of all men, potentially. And why do I say potentially? Because he says, especially, specifically, of those who believe. See, what he did is enough for all men, but Jesus himself said that light has come into the world, but men love darkness more than the light. Neither would they come to the light, lest their deeds be exposed as evil. It's not, he said, this is the condemnation. That's why men are condemned. Not just because they're sinners, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, because they're sinners who refuse to repent. And I can tell you today with absolute assurance, God's will is that you would find salvation and forgiveness in Christ. If you've never given your life to him, when we get to the end of the service, I'm going to give you that opportunity. If you've given your life to him, but you're not living your life for him, well, change that today for sure. But the idea is that I can tell you it's not God's will you perish. And that should bring some hope to your heart. But it says, but that all come to repentance. What's repentance? Well, it involves a couple steps. If you're going the wrong way, you got to turn around and go the right way. If you're believing a lie, you got to turn around and believe the truth. If you're walking in darkness, you need to walk in the light. If you're walking in hate, you need to walk in love. But you don't just decide to do those and think it's going to happen. No, to repent requires confession. You can confess, though, and not repent, but confession is simple. It's just saying what God says about that thing. We'll call that thing sin without getting to everybody's stuff. But if it's not the will of God for you, it's sin. And so if you're living in sin, he's calling you to confess that and to acknowledge that the wages of sin is death. You're going to die physically because sin's in the world, but you're going to die spiritually, or you're already dead in trespasses and sin. And if you don't give your life to him, you will die in your trespasses and sin. So all of that to simply say this, that if you believe and you give your life to the Lord, you pass from death to life. It's not his will any perish, but all come to repentance. And people have asked, well, couldn't God just force the issue? Sure, he could, but he's not going to. He chose you and he gives you a choice to choose him in response. And so, in any case, God's the Savior of all, especially, specifically of those who believe. And he says, these things command and teach. Sufficient for all, efficient for those who believe in him, confess their sin, turn from it, and put their faith in him. Let no one despise your youth, verse 12, but be an example to the believers in word and conduct and love and spirit and faith and impurity. Everybody grows old, some grow up. And Timothy was young, but he was mature, as I already shared, in the faith. And when he says, let no one despise your youth, you can't help that from happening. You can't keep that from happening. But what you can do is make sure you give them no reason to despise your youth. Rob them of any reason to do so. Be an example to the believers. And this is important because this is an imperative. That means this is a command of God. And it's present tense. That means be an example at all times to every believer in every situation. And he's focusing on Timothy and his relationship to the church because he's pastoring the church. But we're supposed to be living this way before the world, so that if they look at you and say, well, what do you know? You're young. They will feel ashamed that they ever accused you of any of the things they've accused you of. So be an example in word. Words come from where? From the heart. I read you Jesus' word on this. And our words will either build up or they'll tear down. They'll either encourage or they'll discourage those who hear them. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So be an example to the believers in word and conduct, because actions speak louder than words. In my early years here, and I know I've played you songs that I wrote when I was a young Christian, that was long before I was here. Well, 5 years before I was here, actually. But nonetheless, I wrote a song when I was first probably teaching through a passage like this. And it says, your walk talks and your talk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. And if you'd like to hear it, good luck, because I don't remember anything except that about it. Now, God could bring it to my remembrance. He's done other things. But you can remember the phrase, and that's really all you need. Your walk talks and your talk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. And that includes those loud people among us. I happen to be one. So words come from the heart, or build up, or they tear down. They glorify God and bless people, or they don't. Conduct in love. Already made mention, four Greek words for love. This is agape. It's selfless, it's giving, it's unconditional. It's the kind of love God has for us. And sadly, tragically, it's the same word that's used when it says they won't come to the light because they love the darkness more than the light. They're not enamored with it. They're not attracted to it and the way of Eros or you know, a friend of it like Philos or Storge. No, they agape the darkness. They're willing to trade everything, all God has for them, to hold on to the darkness that has a grip on them. So agape love is selfless. It's giving. It's unconditional. Jesus is the prototype. And there's such good news because there is a day coming when we are going to be just like him. I'd like to say that day's today. But that's only true if the rapture, the trumpet sounds and the dead in Christ rise first and we are caught up with them in the air in the rapture, because when we stand before him, we will see him as he is and we will be like him. It's his promise. We know what he's like. So if you're married and you're like, man, I sure wish my husband would be more like Jesus, he will be. And I'm encouraging him to be more like Jesus every day. And for you to be more like Jesus every day. But we will be perfected, not this side of heaven. That actually happens in heaven. So an example to the believers in word and conduct and love, in spirit and faith. Listen, to be found faithful, we must walk by faith. And how do we obtain faith? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It keeps coming back to the word of God, because this is his love letter to us. These are his words to us. This is his will for us. It's his promises to us. And then it says, in purity. I don't have to tell you, guys, gals, you're growing up at a time where social norms are ungodly, unholy, impure, perverse, idolatrous, perverted. So you living a life of purity, that's going to make you stand out. And I know not everybody wants to stand out. When you're young, especially, you know, you just want to go along and get along. But as a believer, you're the light of the world. How do you hide the light from people who are in darkness? Do you know light and darkness have no fellowship? Scripture says so. They have nothing in common. And so if you're going to fellowship with someone who's in darkness, you're going to have to go into the darkness and hang with them. I'm saying it's fine to pull them out, but it's not fine to dwell there with them. And so if you're going to walk in the light, they're not going to have fellowship with you until they come into the light, until they find what God has for them. Purity requires exercising self-control. And the good news is self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. You don't have to try harder. Oh, I'll do better. I'll try harder. I'll stop going there or doing that or looking at that or saying that. The fruit of the Spirit, self-control. If you're born again of the Spirit, you're already sealed with the Spirit and you already have gifts from the Spirit and the power of the Spirit to use those gifts to bless others. But if you struggle in any of these areas, self-control, it's like, Lord, control me. I give you myself. Use me, transform me, do your thing in me. Then he says, verse 13, and this surprises some, till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. The word, this is what surprises some, that the reading here isn't just reading your Bible. At the time this was written, first century Roman Empire, less than 1% of the population was literate. And so if you were literate, you were a scholar in those days. And so the priest, they had to read. But the common people didn't read. So when it says giving attention to reading, it's talking about reading the Word of God in public. That's why we go from Genesis to Revelation and we read it and explain it and then encourage you to be doers of it and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. So listen, it's used in Revelation 1:3, and Pastor Jacob is closer to the end of his study through Revelation on Saturdays than he's ever been. I think he just did chapter 20 last night, but Revelation 1:3, blessed is he who reads, and it's reads publicly. And those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep the things which are written in it, for the time is near. It's a glorious picture. People need to hear the Word of God. And you can read it. Man, we have so much access to it. But there's a whole generation of people who call themselves Christians but have never even read the Bible. Are they not Christians? Only God knows. But if they were saved somewhere where they're like, the Bible, don't need the Bible. That guy's going to pay for saying that someday. And those who buy into that, they're going to pay for a while at least. The exhortation here is to be doers of the word, to obey and flee the wrath to come, to warn the unruly, to comfort the faint-hearted. The doctrine, preaching truth, teaching what's right and wrong in the sight of God. Do you know that when the Bible defines maturity, it does it surprisingly by saying the ability to know right from wrong. God calls that the beginning of real maturity. So it's like lots of people say they know, but he's saying not everybody knows. And today, it's not just people don't know right from wrong. They're doing what Isaiah said they would do. They would substitute light for darkness and deception for truth. And everything God wants for us and has for us and has promised to us, it's all in the light. It's all in the word. It's all from him and it's in his word. So the exhortation to be doers of the word, to obey the word, to flee the wrath to come, to warn the unruly and comfort the faint-hearted. Doctrine is preaching the truth till I come, reading, exhortation, doctrine, teaching what's right and wrong. And again, 15 times the word doctrine will appear in 1st and 2nd Timothy and in Titus, and they're short books. So Jesus warned about the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and such. The Pharisees, it was religious hypocrisy. The Sadducees, it was trying to accomplish the will of God by partnering with Rome, which was like the ultimate compromise. Well, last couple of verses, and then I have something from 1 John, a short clip, and we'll worship. Finally, he says to Timothy, and I say to you today, do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you. In Timothy's case, by prophecy, with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Listen, every born-again believer is sealed with the Holy Spirit. We're all called and we're all gifted and we can all be empowered Timothy was going to pastor the flock, so they laid hands on him. They didn't ordain him to ministry, because only God can ordain one to ministry. But they ratified God's call on his life. The character, the lifestyle, the knowledge of the word, his obedience to the word, all that we read about him here. So he says, don't neglect the gifts God's given to you. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Ponder, practice, progress, so we will all see the evidence of your growth in Christ Jesus. And so all who aren't here with us will see the same thing. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. To deliver, that word save means to redeem. It's translated elsewhere, deliver or make whole or preserve from loss or from destruction. So the pictures that are developed for us in this chapter and in the preceding and the ones that will follow are of someone who has the word, who lives the word, who loves the word, who walks in light and truth and faith and such. 1 John 2:12 says this, John writing to different groups in the church. You'll be in one. I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you've known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you've known the Father. I write to you, Father, because you've known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you and you have overcome the wicked one. Lord, I'm so grateful for your word. I'm so grateful for the way you took Pam and I out of the darkness and brought us into the light, for the faithful pastor you gave us and the faithful men who served alongside of him, the faithful women that ministered at Calvary Costa Mesa too. And Lord, I'm so grateful that you've raised up an army of believers here. And truly, Lord, we're here to get our marching orders, to be reminded of the things that have no place in our lives, to be reminded of the things you've purposed and planned for our lives. And Lord, I pray for all my brothers and sisters here today, that anything that's hindering, that anything that's confusing, that anything that's dragging them down or keeping them from fully experiencing and living out your will for their lives, that this would be a day that they ask for forgiveness, they confess their sin and ask you to cleanse them afresh. And then tomorrow and the next day and the day after, they would recommit and live the life you've called them to and made possible for them in Christ Jesus. If you're here and you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus, today is the day of salvation. And you can believe all the right stuff about Jesus. You can believe he's the Son of God and the Savior of the world. You can believe he died for our sins, was buried and rose again. You can believe all that and still end up in hell, because the demons believe and tremble. Satan knows who Jesus is, but he's not going to be with us in heaven. You have to believe unto salvation. You have to put your faith in Jesus and in him alone, in his promises to you, his blood shed for you, died for your sins, buried and risen again, ascended into heaven, promising to come for us, that we'd be with him there in the Father's house and at the throne of the Father, that we'd return to rule and reign with him when he returns to the earth after the 7-year tribulation. Listen, if you've never given your life to him, today is your day. And I'd ask you if you're ready to say, Pastor, pray for me right now, right here. I want to give my life to the one who died for my sins, was buried and rose again. Would you just raise your hand and hold it up high, high enough for me to see you and acknowledge you. And I'll pray for you and I'll pray with you a simple prayer like, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus, thanks for giving me this this hope of heaven and this opportunity to surrender my life to you, to become the person you created me to be in the first place. Give you my life for now and forever. If that's your prayer, please, if you've never prayed it, let me pray it with you. Anyone this hour, anyone this service. Awesome, I see your hand here. Anybody else want to join this gentleman and say, me too, not another moment walking in the darkness, not another moment walking without Christ. Anybody else want to pray as well? You who raise your hand, pray these words aloud after me. Brothers and sisters, feel free to pray along. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me, for choosing me, for convicting me of my sin, for convincing me of your love, for sending Jesus to die in my place and for my sins. Gave his life for me, so I give my life to you. He died for me, so I'll live my life for you. Seal me with your Spirit. Teach me your word. Make me the man you created me to be and now have saved me to become. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's welcome this brother into the family. Awesome. We have a short clip, 2-minute clip, then Rich will be back up and we'll have one last song for you.
Hey, Square.
I am not a square. I
think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
They need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down, man, slow down.
Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
Oh, yeah, those pictures of Pirate's Cove, that's where Pam was baptized. And my little brother, too, a whole bunch of other people, like tens of thousands of them. But anyway, we're showing you that because they're going to have this at Cinemark 14. And so we will get a copy and we will show it later here, but it would be really good to go there and invite someone and take them. And so the date's there, I think it's 24th, and they'll be showing it in multiple theaters, and they'll be showing it at different times. But anyway, now you know about it, Jesus Revolution, log on, get more information, find out what's going on in the theater, get a bunch of friends together. It's going to be really fun, I promise you. It's probably more fun for me even than you, because I've been those places, and I know those people. But anyway, let's stand for a last song together. And you who gave your life to the Lord, please come down. We want to, when we're done, Got a Bible for you, a little pocket Bible, and we want to welcome you and embrace you and give you a welcome hug into the kingdom of God. Did you notice they got Jesus to play Lonnie Frisbee in that? That's a score.